afternoon. Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon. It's a communication school, so we sort of like to do that. My name is Ernest Wilson. I'm the dean of the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism, and I welcome you wholeheartedly to this wonderful event. This is a special occasion for us. It's really, we feel it deeply in our heart. It's a part of our tradition, and it's a part of the excellence of the Annenberg School. It is the 10th anniversary Everett C. Rogers Award Colloquium. We've been doing this, obviously, for 10 years. It's very important for the life of the school. Ev Rogers was a professor on the Annenberg faculty and also associate dean of the school. You may know him through his work on issues of the diffusion of innovation, for example, which is one of the most widely cited research efforts in the entire social sciences. Very important work that he did a number of years ago. And even if you don't know him, you know the term that he introduced to explain how technology proliferates. He was the one who used the term early adopters. So I know that everyone in the room has heard that term. When he died in 2004, the Annenberg faculty established this award to celebrate innovators and pioneers in the area of Ev's work, which was very, very wide-ranging, from using entertainment to inspire social change, to harness the power of networks, to overcome cultural barriers to communication. Since its outset, the award has been administered by the Norman Lear Center at Annenberg, whose director, Marty Kaplan, we'll hear from in a moment. In all that Ev Rogers did, there was a key element to things that he spoke about and wrote about, and that is what we call communication at the center. It's the center of our daily life, our individual life, our collective life, our national life. And that's an idea that is very much central to what the Annenberg School does today. Today, we're absolutely thrilled to welcome to USC and to the Annenberg School for Communication and Journalism the 10th winner of the Ev Rogers Award, Rosabeth Moss Kanter. She has an amazing biography. Her work is widely cited around the world in a variety of different fields. She is the Ernest L. Arbuckle Professor at the Harvard Business School. She is chair and director of the Harvard Advanced Leadership Initiative, preparing leaders at the top of their fields across the board and from around the world to transition to their next years of service. She is the author or co-author of 19 books, including Confidence, which is a New York Times bestseller, and the award-winning classics Men and Women of the Corporation, and my favorite, The Change Masters. She's translated her wide-ranging research on corporations and sports teams and entrepreneurs and other important actors also into action, working with professors not only in universities but also with some of the top executives in some of the most important fields around the world. I want to thank the award jurors who made this year's selection, several of whom are with us today, and I want to introduce the chair of the jury, who is a colleague of Ed Rogers here at the school. And as I, just before I ask Peter to come to the podium, I do want to again thank the really good work and leadership that has been provided by Marty Kaplan and his colleagues at the Norman Lear Center. They've done really wonderful work over the years in making sure that Ev is recognized and done in a really appropriate and impressive way. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Peter Clark, one of the stars of our school, and so I will ask him to come up and make a few remarks. Peter?
Thank you very much, Dean Wilson. And I want just to say a word or two about Ev, as one who knew him well during his lifetime really at two universities, the University of Michigan and the University of Southern California. His career is, as Ernie has briefly described, was exceptional. His book, The Diffusion of Innovations, has been cited literally tens of thousands of times, as have many of his other works, both articles and books. But it's a little bit of his character that I want to leave with you. I was dean of the school when he came here in 1985. And I remember him coming to me one day and saying, you know, I think I could be of great help to the school if I taught your main undergraduate introductory communication course, one that had several hundred students at the time. How many faculty come and volunteer to teach an introductory course? And that tells you a lot about Ev's spirit and his personal connection with students. He was revered as a teacher. He was revered as a colleague. He was a Pied Piper to graduate students, infecting them, as Nosh Contractor said last night, one of our jury committee members, and Doe Mayer is another one here today who's part of this committee, infecting students with the idea of communication networks, to the point that forever after in their careers, they could never fail to find these in every phenomenon that they looked at. So I want you to think of the man, the person really who we're honoring today, as more than a stellar scholar, but as someone who was a stellar human being. And it was with great sadness that we bid him adieu in 1993 when he left to teach at the University of New Mexico and later become chair of the communication program there. He died in New Mexico in 2004. He was born in Carroll, Iowa in 1931, the son of Iowa farmers, and a person who never left the life of the soil, if you will, an identity that he carried with him all of his days. It now gives me great pleasure to introduce Marty Kaplan, who is director of the Lear Center, and a very valued colleague of mine and of our committees in making this award each year. Marty?
Thank you. It's a perilous exit.
Thanks very much, and thanks for being here. This is an exciting occasion. I have been an admirer of Rosabeth Moss Kanter for so long, and to have her at our school is a great pleasure for me. Her field is so broad that it's almost impossible to say what she does without saying and. Strategy, innovation, and leadership for change are the biggest headings, but she consults for companies, for cities, for sports teams, for CEOs, for nonprofits, for executives looking to have social impact careers to follow their main career. There's almost no arena where she's not engaged, and that's something that was true about Ev Rogers, and it's also something true about the Lear Center. And so for those of you who don't know the Lear Center, I invite you to our website, which is learcenter.org, to find out more about us. Ernie told you some of her biography. For me, I'm trying to boil it down, and so I found a way to do it with numbers. 50, 19, 24, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 1. I'll tell you what that... Oh, that's probably enough. I probably don't... There's an old joke about someone calling out a number. You probably know that joke. 50 is that the Times of London listed her as one of the 50 most powerful women in the world. I love that. She is, as Ernie said, the author of 19 books. Her most recent book is called Move, and it's amazing. She has managed to make infrastructure a sexy topic. So much so that Jon Stewart invited her to be on The Daily Show to talk about it. And if I ever had a dream, it would be to have an invitation just like that. 24 is the number of honorary doctoral degrees that she has received, which is mind-boggling and wonderful testament to your work and your career. That other string of numbers, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, proves how ahead of her time she has been. You know the expression link bait? That the web, it has been found that if something has a number in it, that people are more likely to click on it. And so often links, headlines are written to contain that. And Rosabeth Moss Kanter is the master of such things. And this was the case before it was true on the internet. So for example, five powers that get ideas off the ground. Six ways to befriend future billionaires. Seven skills of change masters. Nine rules for stifling innovation. And 10 reasons winners keep winning aside from skill. And so you can find that throughout her work. It's tremendously exciting to be able to go right to the core of what you want to know about something. I have a special affection for Professor Kanter, which is born both in the fact that we first encountered each other in the 1988 presidential campaign, where she was a leading advisor on domestic issues and I was a volunteer speechwriter. Our candidate did not win. But then neither of us suggested that he wear a helmet when inside a tank. So, but in any event, the combination of scholarship and activism is a key to her career. And also, she is a colleague and was a dear friend and had great affection for her and she for him, and many of us here, including me, are in that same category, and that was Warren Bennis, who many of you know, who was a great pioneer in leadership studies, and I can't think of someone who is a more worthy heir to that tradition. And so the other number that I ended with was the number one, which is that she is the number one, the winner of the Ev Rogers Award, and so I'd like to invite her to the stage to receive it.
How lovely. How
congratulations.
Wonderful. Thank you. How wonderful. Thank you.
And I'm going to hold this for safekeeping. How's that?
I think that's wonderful.
Great.
Okay. And now it's up to me?
It is.
Okay. Thank you. So first of all, Marty, thank you so much. That was really wonderful. Dean Wilson, Professor Clark, I'm so honored to be here, not only to get this award, but USC does hold a special place in my heart because of Warren Bennis and my long relationship with him. And so I knew this is a very special place, and I've been enjoying greatly getting to know more about what the Lear Center does, and I'm very impressed. So I hope to be in that tradition in talking about how we create a better world, how we make change. And, you know, change, I'm going to talk about a culture for innovation, but that's really all about change. It's about new ideas, putting them into use. It's about entrepreneurship. Change is a difficult topic. I mean, I struggle with change. I actually personally hate change. because change is generally what somebody else is making me do. But what I love is I love new ideas. I love things that I am initiating, and I think that's true of all of us. Change is a threat when it's done to us, but it's an opportunity when it's done by us. And we're living in a time where questions of change, how we change, are absolutely central to the kinds of lives we lead and everything we do. And since the time Everett Rogers did his work, we have come around to seeing change differently. I mean, he was part of a tradition, I think, that came out of World War II, in which social psychology burgeoned as a field because the government wanted social psychologists to help them understand how to get people to do what the government wanted them to do. That was really the origin. It was persuasion to get people to buy war bonds, for example. How do we do that? And that was the origin of many of these fields. And that has continued, that tradition continued for a while, where change was all about what we were making other people do, and communication was an instrument, a tool to get people to change their behavior in ways that would suit authorities and establishments. And I remember when I was a baby professor, and by the way, that campaign that Marty and I worked on, I had just become eligible to vote, that I was approached when I was a baby professor, baby consultant, by a very large, very distinguished company that said, "Will you come and help create a training program on change?" And I got very excited because my view of change, aside from not liking people doing it to me, was that it was all about empowering people to seek ways to develop their ideas. I had that view from the very beginning of my career. It was part of wanting to open opportunities to women. It was part of creating new kinds of social structures and social systems. It was about solving problems. It was about innovation and entrepreneurship that could make lives better. So I got very excited when this large company approached me with that idea. And I said, this is really wonderful that this big bureaucracy wants to give people an opportunity to learn to master change by doing it, by creating the change. And they said, no, no, that's not what we have in mind. What we have in mind is that you help us teach people how to be more receptive to the changes we want them to do every time we introduce a new program, a new policy. And we parted company at that point. And by the way, the large company increasingly had issues with the question of who is the originator of innovation and change. There was a period of time in around the same time as that ill-fated campaign, which would have changed our lives, that ill-fated campaign when that company was in trouble. And it was trying to be a solutions company. It was in technology. And it was trying to be a solutions company that would offer solutions to their customers. And again, I thought that was really terrific, a wonderful shift of mindset. But then a senior vice president in the company was widely quoted as saying that if customers don't like our solutions, they've got the wrong problem. So there's an honorable history of not thinking about innovation as something that emanates from the people, innovation as something that creates new possibilities that have not been envisioned by people who are already in power. And that is the kind of, that is not the kind of culture that provides innovation. Innovation is part of what gives us the opportunity to express a part of ourselves that's equally as important as the anger and fear and preservation. One of the things that is among the many things that are totally annoying to me about one segment of the current presidential campaigns is that it's all about anger and fear and preservation and no change, In fact, get it back to the way it was. And then I hear people saying, but that's a human impulse. And I believe that an equally important human impulse is the impulse to create, is the impulse to improve. And in fact, when I was studying sports enters into this, and yes, I have advised some coaches and teams, because in one of my books I wrote about sports teams as well as businesses and communities and countries, in looking at what creates downward spirals of continuing failure, what creates upward spirals with the momentum of success, and how do leaders turn it around. So losing streaks, winning streaks, and turnarounds from losing to winning. And one of the things I discovered is that losing streaks, you can predict who's going to go downhill, by the way, because losing streaks involve predictable behavior. It's when decisions get made in secret behind closed doors, in which the mode is anger and blame and finger pointing, in which pieces of the same organization or the same company start finger pointing and blaming each other. And as a result, because anger and blame are totally unproductive emotions, they don't lead to action, they don't lead to change, they don't lead to innovation, because they're unproductive emotions, in response, collaboration goes down, ideas are stifled, and people go passive, believing there's nothing that they can do about it anyway. And in contrast, in a winning streak, people believe in possibility. People share information. It's open and transparent. There are opportunities for people to contribute. There's a sense of collaboration and teamwork that comes from valuing one another and believing that if we're in this successful organization or country, then any of our ideas are good ideas and they're worth supporting, and that creates more innovation. So this helps us express the better parts of ourselves, and it also creates dynamic societies, and America needs innovation. We have thrived on innovation. We've been a country not only of immigrants, but of innovators, of entrepreneurs who have created new possibilities. And now, it's hardly surprising today, as opposed to when I had to deal with the big bureaucracies years ago, it's almost a cliche to say we want more innovation. Everybody wants more innovation. Innovation is the thing that we say is going to save us. If new technology might take jobs, well, innovation will create more jobs. New ideas, new ways to use the tools and technology. So there's a great rising groundswell of believing that while the federal government won't do anything for us, entrepreneurs will. And that is now the national mood. So it hardly seems surprising for me to put innovation at the center, a culture for innovation. Well, you know, first of all, I agree that not every innovation is necessarily a great idea. Just because it's a new idea, it doesn't mean it's a great idea. But this is a different world where this is our belief about where problems will be solved. This is what we are counting on to build the future. And what's ironic is those who are suffering due to societal change, who therefore need innovation the most, find it the hardest to generate because of the stifling effects of anger and blame and infighting. And I have talked about these ideas, by the way, not only at the level of businesses and sports teams, but also in countries. I looked at the turnaround of South Africa under Nelson Mandela, and I've been in places like Jamaica, who had believed they were on a losing streak and wanted to know how to change behavior so that they could produce more of the ingredients of the momentum of success. So innovation turns out to be central, and everyone really wants it. Innovation and entrepreneurship are the rage. And in fact, outsiders seem to be in, and anything that looks like the establishment is suspect. In fact, I'm a little apologetic that I come from Harvard University, and especially from Harvard Business School. But actually, I think they're great institutions, so I'm not going to be, you know, play coy here and say they're not good. But you have to feel that if you've succeeded, there's something wrong with you, because that makes you part of the establishment. Well, we know establishments are out, and entrepreneurship is in, and we know that that's true because of the lengths to which people will go to express their ideas and become part of the entrepreneurial world of change. And I actually think that's totally positive. I don't mind encouraging establishments to step aside or to change. In fact, that same entrepreneurial spirit outside can happen inside established organizations, and that's what we need in the digital era, which is disrupting and changing nearly everything. And entrepreneurs will go to great lengths today because it's so in. I am particularly struck by the number of entrepreneurial challenges and co-working living spaces, and that it's a norm now that in many parts of the world that you have to have a business plan. Now, I realize that we're here in Los Angeles where everybody's got a script in their back pocket, but in many of the places where I hang out, Silicon Valley, Austin, Texas, Boston, you have to have a business plan now in your back pocket or you can't play with the big folks. You're not allowed into the conversation. It's all about entrepreneurship. And I just read about an entrepreneurial pitch contest, which shows you how far entrepreneurs will go. It was in Finland, and 20 groups from around the world came to Finland to compete in the midnight pitch contest, in which they had to give their pitch while standing outside in ice-cold water at midnight. Well, you have to really believe in your idea to want to do that. But entrepreneurship is all the vogue, and many cities feel that their revival will be based on entrepreneurship, and so do established companies. And I will tell you in a minute a few of the ways we get a culture for innovation, get the entrepreneurial spirit inside established organizations, because they have to change too. But here's a kind of established organization. This is a global advertising, marketing, and communications firm called the Publicis Group, based in France. It's now the third largest such group in the world. And they want to go through a transformation. The transformation, they're not just creative in themselves, but they want to do more than that. They realize their future, because digital has changed everything, and their business is no longer making 30-second TV commercials. Their business is using new media in ways that interact with people in a different form. And so they understand that their business is not just creativity, that they come up with something cool for their clients, but they have to start inventing for their clients. And that's really a change of mindset, that they have to be ahead of them. And rather than catching up by figuring out how to get on social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter, they might be able to invent the platforms. And so they are, like many established companies now, figuring out how to harness the entrepreneurial spirit in their own company. And so among the things they've done, for example, is they have created, and I will come to the lessons we draw from these examples in a minute, but they have created a set of innovation labs throughout the company where they're trying to invent ahead of their clients. And in fact, Publicis, which was started in Paris, wonderful. If you have been to Paris and been on the Champs-Élysées, you've probably been to Le Drugstore, which is right next to Publicis headquarters, because it was started after World War II by the founder, who was so happy that the Americans had won the war. He loved everything American, and he wanted an American-style drugstore in Paris. So he started Le Drugstore, which sold everything And now these innovation labs for publicists have a little echo of history, because we don't want to forget history even when we innovate. They're called the drugstore. And in the drugstores now, this company is trying to find ways, as a large established company in media, to innovate. So we all want innovation. We all know that entrepreneurship is the wave of the future. Sort of we know that. That is, the people who feel positive and who feel that their areas will benefit, like innovation, it's those who feel left behind, who feel on a losing streak, that are likely to oppose it. And that's always worth remembering. The resistance often comes from people who feel it's imposed upon them rather than something they are able to do to create a better and brighter future. So, you know, everyone wants more innovation. I get asked all the time by organizations to come and tell them how to get more innovation, which is what I'm about to talk about. And sometimes the first question I get is, we want more innovation. Who else is doing it? All right, well, I kind of laugh at the irony of that, because the whole idea of innovation is that you're doing something novel. It takes courage, because you're doing something nobody's ever done before, and you can't necessarily prove it yet. So that's in the nature of innovation. I also hear from companies who say, we want to be innovators, we just don't want to be the first. So same attitude, let's be a little safe rather than courageous. Or I hear, we want new ideas. Nope, not that one, not that one, not that one, not that one. So there's a lot of lip service and not enough acceptance of the fact that there will be mistakes in the innovation process. So let me tell you about some of the ingredients that I think are very important to build a culture of innovation, whether you're building that culture for yourself or in an organization, in a business, in an institution of higher education, in a community, in a nonprofit, or in a country. Here are some of the keys. The first thing is, you do have to be open to lots of ideas. First, innovation only starts because somebody has an idea, and you often can't tell where the idea is going to come from. So there are a couple of lessons about innovation that I've learned through the years and that much research, in addition to my own, backs up. The first thing is, if you want more successes at innovation, you need more failures, meaning you just need more ideas. It's the sheer volume of ideas that starts the process. And a culture of innovation allows thousands of ideas to surface, like a thousand flowers bloom. I find that also ironic, because the man to whom "Let a Thousand Flowers Bloom" was attributed ran a very authoritarian regime. So I guess that's another one of, yeah, not that idea, not that idea, not that idea, but let a thousand flowers bloom. Well, you do have to let a thousand flowers bloom, and they won't all live. And you have to be willing to go on to the next one, but let them surface. And it's also true that innovation comes from unexpected places, unexpected sources, often not where you're exactly looking, and not where it's being ordered by the top. You know, in that era of stifling innovation, when the U.S. desperately needed to have its companies changed, I used to say, tongue in cheek, about participative management, that participation was what the top ordered the middle to do for the bottom. Well, the top can't order people to give them their best ideas. All it can do is create a receptive environment. Otherwise, you have situations, which we have seen, in which people work for a large organization. They find an opportunity, a flaw, a piece of technology. That large organization isn't going to do anything about it, so they spend their time in that company dreaming up their own business, writing their own business plan, and then they leave to start it, and that organization that had nurtured them never gets any of the benefit. That goes on all the time. And it's not just that entrepreneurs would rather not be part of large organizations. In fact, large organizations, establishments, provide an awful lot of benefits to entrepreneurs. But the ideas have to surface. The ideas have to find a hearing. The ideas have to have somebody that wants to accept them. You need a multiplicity of ideas. You need them from everyone, not just the people who are in an R&D lab or are defined as our new venture unit, because sometimes they get blinders on too and don't see new possibilities. In fact, those new possibilities are all around you, from anybody in the organization who experiences the product or has the need. I remember consulting to a large food company that wanted more innovation, and talking to top management and listening to them talk about the problems with getting new ideas. And it then occurred to me partway through the conversation that they had a very large employee body for the products they were already making. And I said to them, well, wait a minute. Doesn't everybody in your company eat food? I said, why don't you ask them? Why don't you ask the people what they're feeling, what they're wanting, and what they're seeing as they travel, what trends? And it's always remarkable to me that people are asked to put aside what they know about life when they enter the door of an organization, as opposed to being encouraged, regardless of their position or function, to be the developer of new ideas. And what's so important about that is not simply that you might get a really great idea out of that that you hadn't thought about, but you also have a culture that's more receptive to the idea of innovation. Because if you're empowered to bring forth ideas, even if it isn't necessarily chosen, you're more receptive to the idea of new ideas. And that can make a huge difference in how quickly a community moves, how quickly an organization can make change. And so you build receptivity when you start big searches for ideas. And so I believe all of these business plan contests, although I wouldn't necessarily go to Finland and plunge in icy water at midnight, but I understand that the U.S. ambassador to Finland did that in order to kick off this event. We are willing to go to great lengths these days. But what you do is you create a receptive environment so that those ideas that are good ideas don't get submerged in the water. They move to the surface. And that is part of a culture of innovation. So we need to find the ideas in the first place, and they're everywhere. It's why crowdsourcing has become the mode. We can't figure it out, leaders say, but I'll bet if we just go to the internet, somebody somewhere has an idea and a solution. And you know what? They often do. Because ideas come often from the periphery, as I said, from the unexpected. But the more you have feeding into the funnel, the more likely it is that good ideas will be heard and listened to. Someone somewhere has the idea. But you also need in an organization to find ideas. You need the time for tinkering, and you need the space to do that thinking and that reflection. And so I think it's become pretty familiar now that Google is one of the companies. There have been companies that are innovative throughout the entire time I've been studying this. Sets aside, allows professionals 15 to 20% of their time to work on projects or ideas of their own choosing. Well, there are those at Google who say that's kind of a myth, but it doesn't matter. Having that myth there, that it is part of your job to come up with things, to have fun coming up with things. And maybe if you feel you don't have any creative ideas, you just go down the hall, talk to a few other people, meet them at the food bar. You hear their idea and you think, ah, that's interesting, I'll build on that. And so it creates an environment in which more ideas surface. So having places and spaces, and to also set really big goals, because I said innovation takes courage. It isn't saying innovation, who else is doing it? I'm only going to copy. I don't want to take a risk. Innovation takes courage, and part of that courage is one of my mantras. I say, act bigger than you are. Take on a bigger idea. As a good friend of mine says, and I tweet repeatedly, by the way, I'm at Rosabeth Kanter. I tweet repeatedly, it takes as much time and energy to dream small as it does to dream big. So you may as well dream big. And you may as well present yourself as somebody capable already of taking on that idea. I was impressed about the Lear Center when Marty Kaplan told me that from the beginning, the Lear Center, which is just a fledgling little thing, right? An academic center said, we're here to illuminate and repair the world. Gee, that's very big. That's a big mission. But if you embrace something big and aspirational, then it's possible also to have people's ideas, minds open up, because as long as their small idea is still acceptable, that is, you don't have to have repair the world immediately, you can take a few years, but it opens up people's minds, they get inspired, they start thinking about things. You know, one big company made a huge leap in their innovation and motivation of employees all over the world, a global company, when they rewrote their values. This is IBM. I'll be using a number of IBM examples because it is, you know, one of the companies that we think of as iconic establishment. Well, it's not really. When Sam Palmisano became CEO in 2002, he thought it was time to refresh IBM values, because IBM values had been laid down in the old era I was talking about of top-down, of telling people what to do. And he thought, this is the 21st century, let's do it differently. And so he set in motion in 2003 a values jam, a jam, like a jazz jam on the web, in which all an immense number of employees, it was about 350,000 at that time, could weigh in on a three-day web chat about what IBM's values should be for the 21st century. So opening up to people's ideas. And it was an interesting phenomenon because there were a lot of fears, a lot of concerns about that. There was a board member on his board who said, Sam, you don't want to do that. That's socialism. Which at that time was a really bad word. I understand now that there are people who think it might be a good word in America, and I know that these days everyone wants to be Swedish. So I say that only partly as a joke. In fact, the Nordic model has been very successful. But anyway, so there was a lot of concern, and they said, what are you going to hear, and how do you open it up, and what do you do if it's only criticism? And he said, well, this is the 21st century. He said, in this century, our employees are educated. They're cynical. They're not going to believe anything we do from the center. They're only going to believe it if they're part of it, and we should hear what they have to say. So they did it. They did it, and they got back something like 140,000 people participated. They discovered what we're partly discovering on the web. For all the ugliness that gets spread, on comments and social media, for all the ugliness that gets spread, there are also people that police the negative because they want the positive. And so in the first day when some people were negative, people said, get over it, what's your solution? And by the end of this time, they had a huge amount of input, and there was a committee. There had to be some people who boiled it down, and they boiled it down to three core values. The centerpiece, the second core value, was innovation that matters for our clients and the world. And that phrase, and the world, turned out to make a huge difference in how people felt in other countries about working for this giant and what difference they could make. And I saw this through interviews in 22 countries. That was an immense project. But We heard from people who said that was permission to start thinking about the world outside the company. And when you start thinking about the world outside what's established, you get new ideas because you see problems and you say, hey, I wonder how our technology could solve that problem. And so you get new ideas. So opening up the conversation to many people and seeking their input and their ideas. And by the way, IBM also got out of that development of a technology to run those massive web chats without crashing. And that was a huge benefit. And they did it later to have the entire company vote on innovation priorities. Would you believe that a large company would have people vote on what our priorities should be for the future? But they did it. And that was courageous. It didn't solve all the problems of bureaucracy. It didn't solve all the financial problems, although they want to do it now. But that's the first thing. Where are you going to find the ideas? And the answer is that you ask people and you let them get involved. That was subversive, by the way, when I said those things in 1983. Totally subversive that you ask people and let them get involved. Today, especially among the new generations, they won't have it any other way. I mean, try to tell them what to do as opposed to asking them politely if they will volunteer to do their job and have an idea about a better way to do it. And that is the way to treat people today. But then the second thing you have to do to have an innovation culture is that you have to be able to develop the ideas into something workable. Because just having an idea, ideas are a dime a dozen. There are so many ideas. There are things we want, things we do. You actually do need solutions. You actually do need actual models and prototypes and something you can show. And there was a time in Silicon Valley when you could get funded from the back of an envelope. You just had a concept like, hey, let's set up a website where we will ship pet food. People love their pets. They have to replenish pet food all the time, pets.com. And it got a lot of money. Of course, it didn't figure out how heavy it is to ship dog food. It's still amazing to me that Amazon has a flourishing business shipping you diapers if you have a young child, but they do, but maybe that's more cost efficient to ship now. But you have to develop the idea into something. And developing the idea, developing the dream also needs a culture, but now it's a culture where people talk to each other, where people collaborate, where people who have a big vision work together to get it, because nobody does these things alone. Maybe a thought leader can do things alone. And by the way, Marty, those 24 honorary doctorates, you have to like commencement a lot in order to do that. But I mean, there are some things you can do alone, but otherwise you need a team, you need partners, etc. And you need the flexibility to keep changing your mind. So developing ideas requires what I think of as disciplined flexibility. And it requires pulling together all the people who might have something to contribute to the idea. So you crowdsource, you get a lot of ideas, but then you have to crowdsource a team. You have to put together people who will complement each other to build it. So here's another IBM thing. IBM has a breakthrough in, it used to be called artificial intelligence. I won't use that word anymore because that's another one that seems kind of ugly to some people, like they're going to replace my mind. My mind is irreplaceable. No, so they call it cognitive computing. That is computers that can process a lot of data and come up with answers that nobody had put in there. And they demonstrated that first by picking a big goal that was not a business goal. The head of the unit that developed the technology called Watson, clever name, because that was the founder, called Watson. He said, we need a goal to unite the team behind something sexy and exciting. And so he said, hey, why don't we try to beat human players at Jeopardy? So I don't know how many of you watched the episode of Jeopardy in which this cuddly little computer. They made it look like R2-D2 or something with flashing lights. It was actually something like 18 servers and but won Jeopardy. And it was because this team had a goal, had a collective sense of what they might achieve that would be fun. I mean, you don't develop ideas as a chore, because we'd rather put our brains, you know, leave our brains at home and just bring our bodies to work. Otherwise, if it's a chore, they made it fun. They created a team. And the way the team did it, actually, they started discovering that even a small development team could operate in silos. And so one person would come and say, well, I'm a little stuck on this because the person over there hasn't yet given me what they're going to do. And then someone else would say the same thing. And the head of the team was calling up people saying, why don't you talk to each other? Then he had a brainstorm. He said, put everybody in one room. Now, that seems pretty simple, right? And yet we don't often do it. Have a collective goal, a collective definition of success, something that we all care about, and we're all together communicating about it. That's incredibly important to a culture of innovation. And when you do that, you often have unexpected developments, unexpected events. And if you're all together, you can work on it together. Because a lot of strategy, especially for innovation, is improvisational theater. It's not like traditional theater. So I'm using lots of communications metaphors and ideas here because I'm at the Annenberg School and the Norman Lear Center. But this is a classic distinction I've made between strategy as traditional theater, which means you write a plan, you write a script, you work on perfecting the script, then you tell everybody their parts and they can't really deviate from those parts or they'll ruin the whole idea. That's traditional. That's the way we often do routine things. But if you want innovation, you need it to be much more like improv, where you have a theme, you have this audacious goal, like we're going to beat the human experts on Jeopardy. You have a goal, and you start trying things. And if it fails, you test it in front of audiences. In the tech world, they call it rapid prototyping. You create a prototype, you test it, you get audience feedback, the audience talks to you, and eventually you refine it enough with users in mind that you make a big difference. And so improvisational theater matters. There's a company now in Silicon Valley that is one of the unicorns, the companies who reach $1 billion in valuation. And it's done it early. It's called Slack. Any of you Slack users? Aha, see, a lot of you. This is very California. But Slack has done incredibly well. Do those of you who are users know how Slack started and what its first product was? It had a different name then, too. Slack started with, they were going to be a massive multiplayer game on the web. That was it. They were just for fun and games. That was its business, and it didn't work. But they had a lot of investors with sunk costs, and they had a lot of people that loved the idea of what they were doing, and their models, their prototypes hadn't worked, so they went on to figure out another one, very improvisational. And the next one was, if you have a multiplayer game, why not a multiplayer, multi-colleague communication system that helps everybody find out quickly not just how to communicate, but also all the threads and discussions and who's doing what. And that's what Slack has done. In some ways, that was pure improvisational theater. And if you're not open to continuing, when your prototype doesn't work, you've got users, you've got an audience, they'll tell you, and you move on with what the development is. And we often develop things very serendipitously in the innovation world. In fact, there was a dramatic improvement in screening women for breast cancer because of the Hubble telescope, which was scanning space. And because the initial telescope created very fuzzy images, the scientists had to figure out how to take very fuzzy images and refine them. And then somebody realized, not only did they get better images of outer space, but you could use that for better images of the body and use it diagnostically. So strategy is improvisational theater. You need disciplined flexibility. That is, the team has to be solidly together and yet be willing to be flexible in a culture of innovation, to develop innovation. And you need to be attentive to all of your users, all of your stakeholders. So my quick example of that is the strange case of Uber. Uber, I'm fascinated by Uber. Uber has huge consumer demand. People love Uber. But Uber is banned in many countries, some cities, and has managed to reach a market valuation of $62.5 billion while pissing off, excuse the language, practically all of its stakeholders. There are reasons for nearly everybody to be angry at Uber. Now, clearly, big consumer demand has helped them, but because they have not worked on those relationships with stakeholders, Lyft is coming along fast. And there are many people, especially after an Uber driver shot a lot of people in Michigan, a lot of people said, I think I'll call a Lyft. Not because Uber could have screened them out, but because Uber could have responded more responsibly to its stakeholders. Uber knew early in the day that there was erratic behavior on the part of the driver, and it could have cut off that driver immediately while they investigated, instead of saying, not our fault, we're just a software platform. So you don't move innovation forward. You know, you can get it off the ground, but you don't really move it forward unless you know how to work with all the stakeholders. And so I talk about that as a particular principle. I say that, you know, there's a familiar saying from the old African proverb, it takes a village. I say it doesn't take just a village. Village is too small. It takes a cross-sector, multi-stakeholder coalition. And as we all say, that doesn't trip off the tongue, but it has been engraved on various bowls and other things by people who have been exposed to this idea. Because to do anything significant, so you can have the ideas, find the ideas, you can get teams behind the ideas, you can even improvise your way to a reasonable product, but then in order to make it bigger, in order to have it reach its potential, particularly if it's an idea you think really will illuminate and repair the world, then you need all those stakeholders on your side, not against you. And so a culture of innovation is also a culture where you don't turn your back on, say, public officials because, oh, they're so establishment, and they just want to hang on to the rules for the benefit of incumbents, which is a sort of an Uber-ish thing to say. That's not the case. In fact, there are innovators among the public sector. In fact, the city of Boston has what's called the Urban Mechanics Lab. It's their version of the drugstore or of an innovation lab. And the city of Boston has developed apps, including one that turns your car into a giant sensor to sense potholes. So they can send out crews immediately. You don't even have to call it in. They are very technology friendly. And so befriending those who are in a position to help the idea move to a bigger scale is really smart strategy. And that's part of a culture of innovation too. And then finally, you definitely need to be prepared for opposition. Because for every innovation, as I said, change is a threat when done to me versus done by me. For every innovation done by me or by us, somebody else feels it's inflicted on them, and they're going to resist. And when are they going to resist? Not at the beginning, because who cares? You're too small. It may never happen. You can do it stealth. You're peripheral. It's when it looks like it's successful and going to succeed. So just when you think your innovation will really surface and your team's or your company's model will take hold, that's when you get the lawsuits. That's when you get the critics. that's when you get the attention that can be negative attention as well as positive attention. Now, it is suspected that Uber kind of liked the negative attention because they got a lot of free media or earned media, and I guess that may be true of a presidential candidate too. But after a while, it does come back to bite people that it's been so negative. And so the middles are very difficult. That's when critics surface. And so I identified what I call Cantor's Law. Cantor's Law is that everything can look like a failure in the middle. And you have to be prepared for that. You need the flexibility to regroup. But if you've done it right, if you have a base of support because a lot of people have had a chance to contribute to whatever you're doing, if you have a team that really believes in it and feels united behind one goal, and if you have befriended the stakeholders early, not waiting until they're ready to drive you out of town, then you can master these middles. And there are inevitable bumps in the road in every attempt to innovate, And so persistence and flexibility are really important in innovation. You know, Newton's third law of thermodynamics, for every action, there will be an equal and opposite reaction. Well, one has to be prepared for that. And therefore, this is where it goes from 1,000 flowers blooming to the 100 or 10 ideas that truly have built commitment of the people along the way. Those are going to flourish. So now in 2016, one of my preoccupations, besides helping more organizations transition to the digital age, understand the realities of innovation and change, harness the forces of technology to be good for the country, to create jobs, rather than to be a source of fear and trembling. In addition to that, I'm preoccupied with the same thing the Lear Center is, of repairing and illuminating the problems of the world. And that's a big mission, and that's one that I want more innovators to do. And increasingly, entrepreneurs are not just building companies. They're building social enterprises. They're building ventures with a social mission, even though they're also going to make money. And I think that is where we need to go in the world, not just as an abstract exercise, as let's understand innovation, but as an imperative for keeping America on the positive path we've been on because we have encouraged innovation and entrepreneurship. And so we need innovation entrepreneurs. We need the 1,000 flowers. Let silly ideas surface too. Let's just have more ideas around us all the time. And in Los Angeles, they don't have to plunge in icy water at midnight. We need disciplined flexibility, receptive users who work with us in an improv way as audience and as participants. We need those connectors between sectors and stakeholders. I think entrepreneurs should be at the table with government policy people, with big business, small business. It shouldn't be a divide. In fact, millennials, I know my Publicis example, Publicis convened its top executives and deliberately dipped into the organization to include also millennials and their voices. And I think that's incredibly and increasingly important. So we need everybody at the table. We need a culture that produces receptivity to new ideas. So I'm going to end with a couple of my mantras, some of which I've already said. One is, if you want a lot of creativity, you do have to go widely beyond establishments. And that doesn't mean establishments are bad, but it means you have to go beyond them. So one of my favorite mantras is that we say for creativity that you've got to think outside the box. I say a box isn't big enough. You have to think outside the building. Because health isn't hospitals. Education isn't just schools. The city isn't City Hall. It's all the things that surround it. It can be ideas from anybody, anywhere outside the building. We can bring them inside the building, or we can develop them on their own, but that's how you get change. The second is, you know, it's as much time and energy to dream small as dream big, so you may as well dream big. And that will motivate people behind something that's inspiring. And then remember, of course, that it doesn't just take a village. It takes a cross-sector, multi-stakeholder coalition. So you got to look at all those that might want to support, or whose support you might need for the idea, and who might have something to contribute. And finally, everything can look like a failure in the middle. So don't give up. If you give up in the middle, by definition, it's a failure. If you keep going with persistence and flexibility, you can make it a success. And that's how we build a culture of innovation. Thank you.
Thank you. That was great. Professor Kanter would be delighted to take some questions. And so for those of you who have some, let us know.
Challenges, testimonials.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
Hold on.
Hi.
For students who are looking to enter some of these more innovative companies, what's your top three list of companies that you think are really at the forefront of innovation?
I mean, naming companies names, that since we're being taped, I'm not sure, because it could change any moment. I think you can find out. But look at the kinds of products, look who's working there. I think startups are exciting, but startups are not the only ones. Look for places that are interested in change. And in fact, even if you're interested in startups, you might want to go to work for something that is in the process of change, that because then you'll learn a lot that you could bring to a startup venture. And yes, I could do my top three, what to look for. Look for how much of their revenue comes from things developed just in the last 2 years. Look at the profile of people they hire. Ask about whether there's some opportunity to be part of a team that develops something new, even if you're doing a specific job.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi.
It seems to me that the founders of Uber, the founders of Airbnb, see the world in a different way than I see it. They see it as globally connected in a friendly, open way. And I wonder, is that how you see the world? And did you always see the world this way? And how did you make the transition?
Well, I mean, it's a really great question, because I think they do see the world differently, but not necessarily along that dimension.
Okay.
Because you're in Southern California, you may have some of this here too, but there is in Northern California a belief that that not only can you create open network peer sharing platforms, but that you don't have to obey the rules, that the rules don't matter. And that's part of and that you don't have any responsibility for the fallout from what you're doing. So that was Uber, and to some extent for a while, Airbnb. We have no responsibility. We're just a dating app. You know, we just match the people who want a ride with people who will offer a ride, or people who have a place with people who want a place. Forgetting about all the other things, we all hate regulation, so I'm sorry to mention this, but all the other things that the rules help protect people against. We need rules for what will be safety. We need rules for what's the degree of responsibility. We need rules for whether the brand stands for something. I mean, I think it probably hurt Uber to be in the headlines as Uber Shooter. If it had said taxi driver, they wouldn't have named the company. But Uber Shooter, I mean, that's going to hurt the brand. So that's one way that they think differently, and they grow up a little and they stop thinking differently. So Travis Kalanick, the co-founder of Uber and CEO, would say, oh, we're just a software platform, so none of that other stuff are things we have to do. But now he's saying, we're a solution to the problems of congestion, and we're going to create traffic congestion, we're going to create greener cities. That's one of those big ideas that's much more inspiring and is more likely to have people on their side. So that's one way they think differently, that the rules don't matter. Well, some rules are silly and bureaucratic, but you might have a way to think about how you help change the rules rather than just ignore them and hope they go away. Uber is banned in a lot of countries, which doesn't help your global business model much. But on the issue of whether the world is open and globally connected, I think, you know, there's a bit of a backlash against that right now, but I see that as a tremendous opportunity and possibility. But then I'm one of those people who actually thinks immigration is a good idea. So I believe in diversity, I believe in opportunity, and I believe that the global connections are important, because actually we would have fewer people beating down the doors of the United States if we were lifting living conditions in their countries. And people are thinking across boundaries, and people who are successful, I'm discovering, have multiple citizenships often, multiple passports, and they're not necessarily against U.S. interests in doing that. So, I mean, this is a conversation we need to have, but I do tend to look at opportunity and how we harness those things as opportunity. The so-called peer economy or gig economy, it has a lot of drawbacks. I mean, not everybody wants to work part-time with no benefits for, you know, offering their home or driving a car. For other people, it's a tremendous opportunity. So we need some ways to create, we now have to create the rules. But we can't make all of that go away. Boston, the open sharing stuff has tended to be of a different kind, partly because we're not totally against rules. So Zipcar started in Boston, and a shared car. And it did start with a lot of great environmental thinking, then became a business, got sold to a company. That often happens. It's like eBay started out so that Pierre Omdiar could trade Pez dispensers for his girlfriend. And then it became a large community auction, and then it became another business. So we see that progression all the time. But the more open global world, we need the protections and the safeguards. And the more that it opens, the more we also have to make sure we know what the ground rules are. Because I don't want my privacy violated. I actually don't buy as much on the web as I would, because I don't want people to know who I am. I want more anonymity, even though I tweet all the time, and I want everybody to know who I am. So, you know, it comes with both opportunities and challenges, but I think there's very little turning back. And I think we just have to make it work for all the people rather than have some people left out. So in my mind, education, retraining, advanced skills for places that never had them is a really important part of making this world work.
Everyone say the question, and then you can do a wrap up.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Sure. Have
okay.
A right here.
Center. And then that gentleman behind.
Thank you so much for coming to talk to us. I'm a student in the engineering school, actually, and I'm always at lectures, and they tell us, oh, it's all about the team and who you surround yourself with. And you sort of emphasize this as well. And I was just wondering, do you have any tips for students as we go through in our careers? How do we find those multidisciplinary teams where we can solve problems together?
Fabulous. Yep.
Hi. I wanted to ask you about this idea of thinking big rather than thinking small and not stopping in the middle. I guess I noticed that certain organizations don't do that because there are limited resources and there's just too much risk involved in what you're advocating. So is there a healthy mindset for certain organizations that may not have the luxury of being courageous to take your recommendations?
Great. So first of all, teams. And is there one more?
Right here.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Allison.
Hi.
Thank you so much for coming. I really enjoyed your lecture. I was wondering if you think that there's innovation goes too far. Technology advancement meets the crossroads of maybe we went too far, I think. Yeah.
Well, I think some things go too far, absolutely. That's why I said not every innovation is necessarily a good idea. Not every product enhancement actually enhances value for people. It's often forces them to change when they don't want to. So whether it goes too far, I mean, if innovation is oriented towards solving problems that have some kind of values and social purpose associated with them, then I think it can be a good thing, even if almost universally a good thing, as long as you're listening to the users, as long as you're using the improv principle of rapid prototyping and get their feedback and find out what it means to them, as opposed to trying to find the perfect thing and then finding a way to inflict it on a lot of people. That won't work these days anyway. And as for the team, well, the team is incredibly important. What do you look for? First of all, you need some compatibility because you want to be able to communicate with each other a lot. And if you don't like each other or feel attracted to each other, that's going to be a problem. You need a common vocabulary. It's why students are in such a good position to be entrepreneurs, because one thing you get by going through school together is you get a common identity and vocabulary that transcends gender or race or ethnicity or class. And it's why the military produced a lot of leaders when they finally integrated, because they had common discipline, common understanding, common uniforms, etc. So you find people with whom you at least share that experience. I find that my MBA students have more in common with one another around the world than they often do with the people from their home country, because they've now shared this intense experience and talk a similar language. So those are a couple of tips for teams. And as far as limited resources, well, one of my colleagues defines entrepreneurship as the pursuit of opportunity without respect to the resources controlled. You have to go for the resources. And one way you go for the resources is partners, big partners, to whom you will give a benefit because they'll be the first to get to use your really cool thing. And crowdfunding is doing some of that. And it's interesting that it's opening up possibilities for people with limited resources. And then you learn to live with limited resources and you do things a stage at a time. And you have to have something to demonstrate because people won't throw money at you. But I think the resource constraint, if the idea is good, if you can find some early users. So here's a story from a very different realm that I'm going to end with. Well, then I'll say something, wrap up, because not just the story. So a very good friend of mine, he has a book coming out on this in the spring sometime. He's the founder of Boston Beer, which makes Sam Adams. And so in the book he has coming out, he tells the story of going for funding in the beginning. He wanted to make a high-quality beer, a superior beer. And he goes for funding, and everybody, venture capitalists are turning him down. They say you have to have revenues up to a certain point. He goes to the bank for bank loans. Well, there isn't enough collateral. And he wasn't looking for that much money. Finally, he had made a batch of the beer, and he served it to colleagues. He was then at Boston Consulting Group, and he served it to colleagues and to other friends, and they really liked it, and they all chipped in. And so he had a pool of money, and after that, he didn't need those other sources because the customers who really loved the beer were funding this company out of revenues. So we went off on a path, particularly in the dot-com boom and somewhat today, where you had to have a lot of capital in order to do things. I say do it with users who love it. The users will help you. If they love it, that means you've got a great proposition. And if they love it, they might help you find ways to fund it, to stretch your scarce resources. So all I want to say by way of finally ending is good luck. I mean, it's exciting that you're thinking these ideas here. And I know that Southern California is becoming a very hip entrepreneurial place and will rival Northern California any day now. Thank you. Thank you.